need signs today, folks. We are joined to the person of the Son, of God's Son. We don't need angels to assist today, how that's taught everywhere in Christendom, because we have the third person of the Godhead himself, God the Holy Spirit, dwelling resident within us and making intercession for us. So we don't need the angelic host. In time past, the Holy Spirit's ministry involved signs. That's how God authenticated his messengers and his message prior to the completion of his word. In fact, God covenanted with the nation Israel to perform what he called my signs. We see that in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 46, in connection with the curses that Israel would incur should they fail to perform as they had sworn they had the capacity to perform under the law contract. Here it is in Deuteronomy 28, 46. And they, the chastisements of Leviticus chapter 26, shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder and upon thy seed forever. This is the law, the second giving of the law here. So God has covenanted to give Israel these signs of how he's dealing with her. So way back in Israel's history, God covenanted to deal with the people of his earthly nation according to signs, visual evidences of his attitude toward them. In fact, he brought them out of their captivity in Egypt through the use of what we might call plague signs. The psalmist said in Psalm 74:9, we see not our signs. The apostle Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 1:22, for the Jews require a sign. Israel had the signs of the kingdom manifested to her. And before God the Holy Spirit completed the book that he wrote, called the Bible, the Apostle Paul's apostleship and message were authenticated through the signs he was empowered to perform. Notice it here in Acts 19:11. And God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. What type of miracles? Verse 12. Well, that's not up here. So that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from those sick folks. And the evil spirits went out of them at the same time with an apron or a handkerchief from Paul. Paul talks about the reasons for the signs he was empowered to employ at that time. And we're going to see when we come to Romans chapter 15, that very thing. Let's sneak a peek while we're back here in Romans chapter 8. Here it is in Romans 15, verse 18. For I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ has not wrought by me, to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed. How? Verse 19. Through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about until Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. Could they read about the gospel of Christ in Paul's epistles? No, they hadn't been written. So, without Paul's epistles being complete, these folks had to have signs that Paul meant what he said, and they were given to those folks so that they could believe Paul. Clearly, God the Holy Spirit was active, folks, when it came to the performance of signs in connection with the ministry of the Apostle Paul. Well, what happened to those signs Paul was empowered to employ? That's the issue. What happened to the signs presented by Paul in light of this statement to the believers today, sitting in 2 Corinthians 5:7? For we walk by faith, not by sight. You know what we could put in there and it would be absolutely correct? Signs. For we walk by faith and not by signs. For we walk by faith and not by little visual evidences of God working in our life. Is the Holy Spirit working through the agency of signs today? Is that the role the Holy Spirit is playing? And is it an ongoing role through the age of grace? Is God giving us neat little things to look at in order that we might be firmed up or encouraged by these things religion would say are God things, little or grand things that we can see? Is God performing God things when the Apostle Paul clearly states, we walk by faith, not by sight? Something for you to think about, wouldn't you say? But what happened to the signs of time past? We need to look into that a little further if we're to understand the role the Holy Spirit is playing in believers' lives today. What happened to the signs of time past? Well, let's continue on and I think we might discover that. What role does the Holy Spirit play in every believer's life today? We began looking at the signs that accompany the Apostle Paul's ministry. You see, many point to those signs today that were being performed by Paul. And many are attempting today to duplicate those signs in assemblies and in arenas and on television programs being broadcast around the world. Now, to be fair, many within professing Christendom refuse to believe the signs that certain denominations say are being exercised in their circles. But do you have to handle snakes or speak in a language you never had to learn in the first place, but were simply gifted with, or cast out evil spirits, or heal or be healed, or experience what some call being slain in the spirit, not a biblical experience in the first place, but widely practiced in our day and time, in order to hang on to the notion that God the Holy Spirit is working through the avenue of visual evidences to show you his place in your life? Think about signs in the sense of visual evidences for a moment. How many do you suppose would dispute the sign gift practices of the charismatic crowd, yet readily accept less grand scale signs, more subtly produced signs, we might call them, such as an empty parking space at a crowded shopping center, or perhaps an unexpected check at a most opportune time, maybe a new job or a new spouse, as being a God thing, the present day expression of religiondom. A God thing, I'm told, is something God has produced or brought about through the avenue of intervention for the purpose of your encouragement, or perhaps just for God to let you know that he's still there, that he's still aware, that he still cares, and that he's still in charge, and that he's happy with you right now, as this God thing has proven his presence, his power, his predisposition where you are concerned. It's a God thing, and it's allowed you to see God's handiwork, his intervention in your present day circumstance. If you haven't heard that expression, you will. It's become the mantra of religiondom today. It's a God thing is the new Christendom catchphrase. The idea being it's a God thing statement. Behind that statement is that this is something that required God's intervention, and look how he's intervened. It's a God thing, the way of pointing to God's intervention. In fact, it's a God thing, when properly analyzed, is a visual evidence of God's intervention in a person's life. That's how we could define it, a God thing, a visual evidence of God's intervention in a person's life. Is God giving us visual evidences to show us how he is working in our personal lives today? Is that how the Holy Spirit is working today, especially in light of Paul's statement of the fact that we walk by faith, not by sight, and that there's going to come a time when false and lying signs and wonders are being displayed, are going to be displayed under the guise of Christendom. But it will be a false Christendom, a false Christ. We walk by faith, not by sight. Is God showing us today what he is doing in our lives? Now, that's different from saying he's not doing anything in our lives. I believe fully the Lord is working in our lives. The Holy Spirit is working in every believer's life. But is he showing us how he's working? Let's take a closer look.